I'm not meant to, you know, that's why the typical Nigerian parents want you their, to be yeah, messy. They don't look for jobs. You might not get the kind of job you want.
But was there a trigger, something that just happened, you're like, come, I can't even deal with Nigeria again.
So it was that. And of course, there was a period I lost an aunt. We're working in a teaching hospital.
Yeah.
And your aunt has diabetes that's poorly controlled and she can't even get in because the hospital is on strike. We have emergency services, but we couldn't get in because it was just skeletal services we were offering. So yeah, I guess that's the trigger right there.
Okay,
I think you're asking, so the routes through the which a doctor can come to the UK.
Yeah.
Okay, so from overseas, Nigeria, of course, the most popular route of getting into the UK here is by the PLAB route.
PLAB.
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to take.
Do you take them in Nigeria or here?
Yeah. So the interesting thing, the exam is in two parts. So you can take the first part in your home country. So I took mine in Nigeria.
Okay.
And of course, you can still take it in the UK if you want. But then the second part, you have to take it in the UK. That exam basically qualifies you to be able to practice in the UK.
My friend Safina, we went to high school together. After school, obviously, went to uni. I'm not even sure what she studied, but I'm sure it's medicine. But you know, she could have done something else. But she's gonna explain everything to you. Yeah, she relocated in 2018, so she's very, very relevant to this video. So I'm just gonna be asking her questions, and I hope it will be beneficial to you. Safina, after KISI, so it's Queen's College Lagos. You graduated. What uni did you go study when you went there?
I went to University of Ilorin. That's where I studied medicine and surgery. Of course, the usual story. Everybody wanted to go to UNILAG, but that was where they would be medicine. And okay. I was just so determined that it had to be medicine, so that's why I went all the way to Ilorin with my family in Lagos.
How long did you study medicine in Ilorin last? Was there strikes and all that crazy stuff?
The thing about University of Ilorin was that I'm not very sure about the current situation now, but back then the strikes were not as much as like other federal universities.
Yeah.
So it was slightly over 6 years. Medicine typically is a six-year
course.
Yeah, so this was almost roughly about 7 years.
Did you do your NYC? What state?
Okay, I did my NYC in Lokoja.
Okay.
Interesting, that's my state of
okay, origin. Okay, that's lucky state, so. NYC is like a 1 year that after uni in Nigeria, you have to go serve the country. And what did you do? Did you teach or did you work in a hospital?
I have to, doctors and dentists always have to work in a hospital.
Okay.
Yeah.
You guys are even lucky. That's quite fun. So after your 1 year doing NYC, was it easy to get a proper job?
Yes, the good thing about medicine, you know, that's why the typical Nigerian parents
want you
their,
to be
they want their kids to always study. You don't look for jobs. You might not get the kind of job you want, the high-paying job and all of that. Of course, in med school, we all had this impression that we're going to come out and be like super rich and everything, you know, but of course, that was clearly not the case.
Just funny how we never know until you're finished with secondary school.
And you're like, you know, somehow they should educate us about these things, but it's a bit too late, 10 years after.
Yeah.
But it was quite easy, to be honest, to get a job. You can do like what's called a training job, or you can do a non-training job. You get paid for both of them. The training jobs are what we call residency back in Nigeria. Obviously, you're working, but at the same time, you're on a definite career path to becoming a consultant, like a specialist or the top dog in your field.
Oh, when you choose your field, because I thought you're supposed to go to the hospital, do different things, and then now like one and choose that one.
Yeah. So right after med school, you do 1 year internship. What we call housemanship.
Housemanship.
Yeah,
that's
so that's when you like get a taste, the flavor of all the departments.
Everything.
Basically, medicine, ONG, pediatrics, and surgery. Like the four main specialties.
So what one did you choose?
Yeah, no, you have to do everything.
Everything. Okay,
everything.
Okay.
And after 1 year of internship, then you go for NYC.
Okay.
So NYC 2 gives you like more work experience and all of that. After that, you can now basically work anywhere.
Okay, so what was your first real job?
Working in a government hospital, Lagos
State
University.
Oh, okay,
So of course I came back to Lagos. Came back, everyone was happy to have me back. I was in a non-training job for about 6 years. Because I was in government, you're just basically working in civil service. So there's career longevity, promotions, usually after every 2 years. But you're not training to be a specialist, if you get what I mean?
Okay, you're just like a general.
Yeah, so whatever department you're in, you're just in that department. But you get promoted like every 2 years.
Okay.
But if you're in this training job, that's residency. Focused on becoming a specialist in that field. So 5 to 6 years, you then become called a consultant.
Oh wow.
Yeah. I did that for about 6 years. You're not specializing. Opportunities and then lapses in the healthcare in Nigeria were becoming more apparent. Yeah, so that's why I now decided, okay, what else? What are my options? What else can I do? That's when I started researching.
Well, was that a trigger? Was that something that just happened? You're like, come, I can't even do it in Nigeria again. I think doctors are the only ones that I can say are really patriotic when it comes to chasing your career, because you're just thinking of human life, this is where you're from. So like, what made you just ginger that come, I can't really do this in this country right now anymore?
For me, I think it was a series of events as opposed to just one singular episode. It was a series of events. Everyone knows about the strikes, the numerous strikes that we always had in government hospitals. You know, you're working, they tell you in 1 to 2 weeks time the hospital is going on strike. And for me, I'm like, okay, fine. We're frustrated because, of course, you're going on strike because certain things have not been done, either in terms of salary, in terms of, you know, infrastructure, in terms of things that the doctors or healthcare workers need, and they're not being done. And, you know, after a series of negotiations with governments, of course, the usual thing, you know, they now decide, okay, we're going to go on strike so that our voices can be heard. So it was that. And, of course, there was a period I lost an aunt because, I mean, like, you know how it is. You're working in, a teaching hospital and your aunt has diabetes that's poorly controlled and she can't even get in because the hospital is on strike. And I'm like, okay, we have emergency services, but still, you know, she couldn't get in because it was just skeletal services we were offering.
Yeah.
And we lost her and she died. Yeah. And, you know, I was just like, So yeah, I guess that's the trigger right there.
People kill and people die. What's the name of
the route through which a doctor can come to the UK? So from overseas, Nigeria, of course, the most popular route of getting into the UK here is by the PLAB route. So that's the PLAB route. So that's like, that's what like everyone does.
Yeah.
Basically, you take a series of exams.
You have to have read medicine. Yeah.
Yes.
Can it be dentistry or something else?
I guess it can be dentistry, but I think there's a different body they register to.
Okay. So the PLAB route is for medical doctors.
It's for medical doctors. So I think basically I'm just focusing on what I know. Medical doctors. No, so that's a series of exams you have to take.
Do you take them in Nigeria or here?
Yeah. So the interesting thing, the exam is in two parts. So you can take the first part in your home country. So I took mine in Nigeria.
Okay.
And of course you can still take it in the UK if you want. But then the second part, you have to take it in the UK. Yeah. That exam basically qualifies you to be able to practice in the UK.
Okay.
So
once you pass.
Once you pass.
Okay. Once you don't pass in Nigeria,
can you just jump on it again?
How much was the exam in Nigeria? How much is the first one? How much did it cost?
Okay, I'm trying to remember because of course, since I'm here, so I've become like a sort of consultant for most of my friends.
Okay.
So I think because I did mine 2 years ago, so I'm trying to remember, but I know it was, if you convert it to Nigerian naira, I know it was less than 200,000.
Okay, and then the one here is the same thing.
The one here was about cost of exams, the cost of
training,
because like there's a prep course that you take just to increase your chances of passing the exams. It's not compulsory, but like it's kind of compulsory because 80% of people actually take that course. And then of course the cost of, you know, coming, traveling down here, your travel expenses, accommodation, you know, everything. So yeah, that was almost about £2,000.
Okay, plus accommodation,
Accommodation. That's
thick. So imagine not getting it, not passing it.
Yep.
Is it over 100 or something? Like, how do they determine?
It's like an oral exam.
Yeah.
So there's like what we call different stations. So they give you like different clinical scenarios. So you're basically trying to do a clinical scenario with an examiner watching you.
Okay.
So it's not
practical.
So it's more like,
So that prep is actually necessary. Yeah. So you even know how to. Ordinary, the BSc I did, when I came to master, write things, how to reference. You would just be lost.
Honestly.
So I can imagine you needing that. So
smart kids who do not even take the prep courses.
And they just
you know, find a group of people to practice with. And
they just do it. So that cost them like £1,000 a day.
No, less than like 1.5.
Okay. So if you're ready, guys, you studied medicine and then you want to come to the UK. How have you found it? So when you passed your both exams, when what was the time scale for them to get back to you?
Okay, usually you can take so you can take anything from 1 month, depending on how proactive you are in terms of having all your documents ready.
Okay.
Because passing the exam is the first part, and the second part is actually being GMC registered, that's registered with the body here.
Okay.
You know? So of course there's some documents you have to get from your license licensing body in your country. In Nigeria, it's like Medical and Dental Council. Okay. So there's some documents you have to get from them. So imagine the, you know, the time it will take to get all those documents processed, the time it will take to actually deliver them to the GMC office here.
Yeah.
So it can take anything from 1 month to about 6 months. Yeah.
Did they tell you all these things on the website, or it was when you did the exam and outside find out for
my goodness, you know how it is. No, nobody tells you. You have to do your own research. So it was from, you know, watching videos like this, going online, you know, and seeing people's experiences. They're quite, so you know, some people have done blogs about how they, you know, their journey and all of that. And also, of course, there's a GMC website, the General Medical Council, that just basically tells you, this is what you have to do. But you know how this kind of website is.
But to be honest, 2005 is not that crazy compared to other things people do, even when you're based here. Like the entrepreneur visa I was telling you about that is now cancelled. It's 50k, you have to, you don't pay them.
But
you
still have to pay.
Yes, in your account, like you need to see it. And then you tell them this is what I want to use to invest. Anyway, that's going to be another video for another day. We're still talking about the medical thing. So how long do you take you to get your job now?
Okay, so the smart thing to do is once you do the exams and you pass, it's best to go on job websites like NHS Jobs, Indeed, and just start looking for
a job. When did you know you passed? Was it the next day?
3 to 4 weeks or so. I know it's not that long. Like, you're still in that state where you're like, a bit tense, like, oh my goodness, what's happening? You still remember the exam. Unlike some exams where you've forgotten that you wrote the exam, and then the result comes out. So I remember, I still remembered clearly what I did. I was like, oh my goodness, what's going to happen?
And it came well. Okay, they say searching NHS jobs.
Yeah, and Indeed website. And then, you know, so the good thing about it, because they're quite, you know, they want to encourage people to come and work here because of the workshop shortage.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can actually get a job even without passing the exams.
Okay.
Like there's some job offers that you have, and you actually tell them that you're waiting for your PAP results. And you know, so it's like they give you a conditional offer.
Yeah. Okay, and then you just work in.
Yeah.
Okay, so
you don't start working, but you know, it's like you get the job, but you know, it's like pending
when, that, yeah, so, okay, yeah, well, you so shall like have
a conditional
okay. And then you were very precise about where you wanted. You wanted London or
Northampton.
That's okay, well,
yeah,
and then you had to settle in,
cast my net wider.
And then you got this one. How are you enjoying your job right now?
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm in a specialist job. It's called oncology. That's cancer care.
Oh.
Yeah. So for me, it took a little bit longer than, you know, most people who did not mind working in A&E. Those are like the common jobs.
Yeah.
A&E, general medicine, and all that. But because I was specific, I wanted to
work in oncology.
So it's a bit tricky.
Yeah.
You know, they know you practice in a different country, so for them it's like that level of trust. How are you going to fit into their system? Because trust me, the systems are totally different. Totally different. It's not a matter of how brilliant you are or how good you are on the job. It's just different, and you need to give yourself time to get adjust, to get used to the system, you know, to know how to practice, give yourself time, because a lot of people, you know, of course, you know, in Nigerians, we used to be like overachievers in everything we do, you know. So you need to give yourself time, you need to pace yourself, and then gradually get integrated.
How are your colleagues though? Were they accepting?
In some cases, to be honest, I found them a bit too supportive.
Much, like,
yes.
This is not coming from the door.
I thought, yeah, thank you. Like, you know, really, you know, I found them a bit too supportive in the sense that, you know, and then you kind of, because medicine is a field where you, no matter how much you read or how much people give you, oh my goodness, she's new, let's give her time to get up to speed. There's some things you just don't know until you're actually doing it, making the mistakes, unfortunately, and keep doing it over and over again.
Okay.
So for me, you know, so one advice I'll give people is, if you're lucky enough to be in a place where they're very supportive, you know, you still have to like challenge yourself that they're being supportive, because it did take me a while, because everyone was a bit too helpful.
Yeah.
So at some point, I now realized it wasn't really helping me. I wasn't doing stuff, you know, so I had to, you know, start demanding, you know, start taking ownership of, no, this is what I want to do. No, this is what's the next step. Okay, I've done this. You said the training period is going to be 2 months. Now it's taking over 2 months.
Yeah.
You know, what do I need to do to get up to here?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So when you start asking questions, you have to be very vocal. When you start asking questions, when you start asserting yourself a little bit,
when did you say, okay, yes, I'm now a doctor in England? Like, how long do you take you to get to that confidence. So that, walk into the office knowing what she's doing.
Should I say I'm still there?
No, that's why everybody's still learning, obviously, as you said.
I haven't practiced for up to a year, so okay. Let me say I'm still there.
How long have you been in this corner?
So I've been working for about 7 months now.
Okay.
Yeah, 7 months. And so I think it's still a learning curve for me. Yeah. And I think a lot of people might be able to relate because I'm still fresh. I still feel like I just got here.
Yeah,
and you know, but so far so good.
Yeah, but you're doing so well. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So amazing. When I found out she was here, I was like, kissing girls, my class, like we're in the same class, same arm. So yeah, thank you so much, Safina, for coming through. Yes, please ask any questions you have. I'm going to forward them to her. Just put in the comment section. I'll hopefully put a link to the Plab or GMC website, anything I can put there, I will put. But any questions you have, make sure you ask her. Thank you guys so much for watching.
My Instagram name, I'm sorry, it's taking me a while. Sapphire01 or Sapphire04, but of course we're gonna attach it to
Thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure you subscribe and click the thumb up button. See you on the next episode. Bye-bye. Okay, bye.